This is the Literary License Podcast with your hosts, Vicky Ray, John Wilson, and Keith Shorgo, discussing book to screen and everything in between, coming at you from the UK and USA.
They keep it real.
Richard Angela! Oh, here you are.
Walking blues, climb the fence, books and pens. I can tell that we are gonna be friends. I can tell that we are gonna be friends.
Come, children, let's be on our way.
Walk with me, Susie Lee, through the park and by the tree. We will rest upon the ground and look at all the bugs we found. Safely walk to school without a sound.
I bet you don't even have your period.
Here we are, no one else. We walk to school all by ourselves. There's dirt on our uniforms from chasing all the ants and worms. We clean up and now it's time to learn. We clean up and now it's time to learn.
I bet you don't even have your period.
Numbers, letters, learn to spell. Nouns and books and show and tell. Playtime, we will throw the ball. Back to class, through the hall. Teacher marks our height against the wall. Teacher marks our height against the wall.
She takes showers when no one can see. She has no hair down below.
We don't notice any time pass. We don't notice anything. Sit side by side in every class. Teacher thinks that I sound funny, but she likes the way you sing. Tonight I'll dream while I'm in bed, when silly thoughts go through my head about the bugs and alphabet. When I wake tomorrow, I'll bet that you and I will walk together again. I can tell that we are gonna be friends. Gonna be friends.
She's a real carpenter's dream. Flat as a board and needs a screw.
That's enough. Fuck off.
Hello, welcome to Literary License Podcast, and today we'll be discussing the 1983 cult classic Sleepaway Camp. And before we get started, let's find out who's with us. Today we have Tom Diamond with us. Say hello, Tom.
Hi, how are you guys? How's it going?
And Tom, as you'll get familiar with him, will be part of our co-host for the Dark Shadows episodes. We'll be starting in July next month. And we have also with us Will Millar. Say hello, Will.
Hey, guys. Hey, how's it going?
And Will will be our co-host for the European Horror segment in Season 3, which starts in September 2019. And we have special guest Dave Campfield, actor, director, producer, and screenwriter of such films as the Cedar and Otto's films, Under Surveillance, and a host of others, and he's with us today. Say hello, Dave.
Hey, guys. I'm very excited to dissect the masterpiece that is Sleepaway Camp.
And before we get started, let's find out what everyone's been up to. So, Will, what have you been up to since last time we spoke to you?
Cranking out content over at medium.com. I'm trying to get at least one to two articles out every week for everyone who's over there and subscribing to me, and getting ready for the next book, which is coming out next year.
And what about yourself, Tom? What have you been up to?
I am looking forward to starting the Dark Shadows podcast in July. I'm doing great right now, and I'm looking forward to working with all of you.
And what about yourself, Dave? What have you been up to?
I just got back from Florida, where I was helping my friend on the production of a Travel Channel show, which is the modern day the modern day In Search Of. It's this high tech, exciting show that explores the world's mysteries. So I was down there on the production end of things, also did a little cameo in front of the camera, and it's going to be coming out in August on the Travel Channel. I've also been working very diligently to get my long gestating screenplay, Awaken the Reaper, finally off the ground. I've been spending roughly 10 years on it. But I got my start with movies like Cesar Nato's Summer Camp Massacre, which stars Felissa Rose in a movie that parodies what we are talking about today. FourthHorizonCinema.com.
And myself, I've just been commissioned to write a script for a computer game out of Montreal, so I'm doing that at the moment, which is quite interesting. So that's keeping me busy, and the podcast, and then watching really trashy television. Getting ready for the finale of Real Housewives of Beverly Hills, because my life is that sad. But other than that, yeah, working 9 to 5, it's like a Dolly Parton song. So.
And I hope you're still watching Dark Shadows.
I'm doing my 25 episodes a month, so I'm there.
Good for you. Good for you.
So what we're going to go on to now is a brief history of Sleepaway Camp. Interesting thing about Sleepaway Camp, it came out in 1983, and it made $11 million at the box office when it came out. I fortunately got to see this at the drive-in when I was in college, so now probably 800,000 years. It's directed by Robert Hiltzik, and he was also served as executive producer, and it stars Felissa Rose, who's become a horror classic screen queen now, and Jonathan Tiersten. So, Dave, do you have anything you want to add about the making of Sleepaway Camp?
Well, I know that Robert Hiltzik was only able to make this movie because his family won a lawsuit, won roughly $300,000 from negligence. I believe a family member died. And as a result, he had all this money. He was able to channel it into the production of this movie. And they shot upstate. And I remember Robert telling me in a conversation, you never know who's going to be the breakout star of a feature. Because here he's thinking Jonathan Tiersten, who later went on to do great performances in movies like The Perfect House. He thought Jonathan was going to be the breakout star. Yes. But lo and behold, Christopher Collette winds up being the star of The Manhattan Project, if I've got that right. So there was some surprising... You know, I've witnessed it myself where you'll witness somebody kind of go from their first movie to become a fairly big star. You never know exactly who it's going to be. So he was telling me that experience. But in essence, Robert was doing his own take on Friday the 13th Part 2, as far as I'm concerned. And it had begun with, you know, Halloween comes out in 1977. It's this big, great slasher film. And then Friday the 13th comes out. And one film seems to parrot the last film to some degree, changing it up just enough to be a fresh take on it. And this is certainly a fresh take on the slasher genre. You rarely see a slasher film that involves pre-pubescent victims. So I describe it as a... John Waters directed a slasher. So over time, telling me about sort of onset, you know, the onset drama that seems to accompany all of these films. I think that at one point she and Jonathan, like, her first boyfriend on set. And they're both like kids, you know. Although, I'll tell you something interesting. Jonathan, while looking so young, was actually 17 years old when they shot that. You know, he looks like he's 13, 14 years old, but he's 17 when they shot. It's called the Ralph Macchio syndrome.
Yeah, the whole Ralph Macchio syndrome. I mean, how old is he now? He's probably about 40. I know that he's done a documentary.
Oh, Ralph Macchio is over 50 right now.
Well, I know Ralph Macchio is, but
Tiersten's roughly the same age. Tiersten is over 50.
Okay, so he looks very good for his age, because I saw the Sleepaway Camp documentary that they made for Scream Factory Blu-ray set, and he's still holding up his age. So what about you, Will? Do you have anything about the making of Sleepaway Camp?
Just a lot of questions about Robert Hiltzik. This was like one of the, he did this movie and then he did like a documentary about this movie like 30 years later and then just went to law school. So like, I find that super fascinating. And Dave, I know that you probably know him, and so I've built up this one idea in my head of somebody who you're like, oh, that's probably not him at all. But it strikes me as really funny that this was like his sort of side project on the way to law school. So you got somebody like, you know how somebody's like side project on their way to law school would be like following, I don't know, the Grateful Dead around or going to India or something like that. This guy shot a slasher film and then just like walked away from that too, right? Like
He returned to it for Return to Sleepaway Camp all these years later.
Right. Yeah. But that's like saying, yeah, it's just he's kind of like the slasher movie version of what's her name, the lady who wrote To Kill a Mockingbird, and then just
or Harper not, Lee.
Am I getting that right? Yeah, Harper Lee. Really. He's like the Harper Lee of slasher movies. That's crazy. Like, you know, he just the one. And yeah, it's as far, if you're going to write one, movie that's just going to not raise questions, Sleepaway Camp probably wouldn't be that one. Cause that one is, he pushes a lot of boundaries in it. That's super interesting.
And, well,
go ahead.
A lot of people lose interest in the film industry after a little while because it is a profession where dreams are broken on a daily basis. So it's not to say that he didn't have aspirations of not becoming a lawyer and becoming a full-time filmmaker for the rest of his life.
Yeah.
But look, I'm in pre-production on one film for 10 years. So to show you how long it takes, that a lot of people are just like, the hell with this, I'm done. So he might have sided with the stable profession because, hey, we always need lawyers. But I don't think that it was his one and done. I think he had a lot more in him, and it just happened to be that, you know, just like so many, he grew disheartened and he went back to his original profession, his original leaning. So that would be my guess. And what's funny about him is how he's, you know, you wouldn't think to yourself, oh, this guy would write a slasher film about a young girl with the lower half of a boy's body. He's a pretty normal guy. And
yeah.
As a result, like when I talk to him, he's almost a little dorky. Like, oh, yeah, so I made this film, and it's about the kids in a summer camp, and the real New York accent, just like a lot of the accents you hear in that film.
Oh, and, it just screamed New Jersey, but of course New Jersey is just, it's what a New Yorker does when he sees things about New York that he wants to project onto something else, like, oh, that's not us, that's Jersey. But yeah, of course, we're all sitting here watching this thing. It's incredible. I loved it. You know, in the same way that you just love anything that's awful and you identify with it somehow, you know?
I mean, the movie did spawn on numerous sequels. Of course, there's Sleepaway Camp 2 and Happy Camper and Sleepaway Camp 3, Teenage Wasteland, that were directed by Michael A. Simpson and starring Bruce Springsteen's younger sister, Pamela. Do we know why he didn't do the sequels? Why they were passed on to Michael A. Simpson?
I can only tell you that Felissa Rose was offered the leading role for both for the sequels, but turned it down because she was going to college. As far as why Robert Hiltzik didn't return, maybe they didn't come to the terms he liked. I mean, that's a very common thing.
Yeah, that is very common.
You know, my first film made $11 million, so I want $2 million. You have no idea what happens behind the scenes. Or they didn't come to an agreement artistically. You know, he might have had a different vision about it, and he didn't probably have the rights. And as a result, he lost it. That's my understanding of the situation. And there's other aficionados out there who know better than I do as far as the specifics of it. Because let me tell you this much. Regarding Sleepaway Camp, there's a pure, rabid fan base out there. I've witnessed it myself. I've been to Fangoria conventions where I saw lines of people waiting for the autographs of these actors. I've had phone calls to my house because I've worked with her asking about Felissa Rose. There is an intense following surrounding this movie. But... yeah,
well, it's quite interesting. I mean, in 2013, they were talking about rebooting the series. I haven't read anything more. I'm doing a little bit of research, but.
Well, there were actually a number of sequels, and I think Hiltzik wanted to go back to the roots in Return to Sleepaway Camp. And he essentially wanted a trilogy. And after the first two sequels, which is he essentially sold the rights to other people.
I mean, I have to sit there and say that his Return to Sleepaway Camp isn't too bad. I mean, the makeup work they did on Felissa Rose was quite impressive.
Yeah. Yeah, I think I don't get why people are so forgiving of the original. It's part of its charm, but expected a absolute perfect masterpiece when it came to Return to Sleepaway Camp. What is that much better about the original than the sequel? Maybe the movie speaks a different language that I don't speak. Because to me, they're both great cult movies. And I'm not sure why one is perceived as so much better than the other.
I guess maybe because there's maybe the long time frame in between the original and the and him returning. Maybe there's always this expectation that it's going to be a certain thing and it doesn't not living up to the expectation of the viewer, maybe, the cult people who love this film.
Right. Maybe the Sleepaway Camp, a lot of people see it as a child and they're still looking at it through the child's eyes. Sort of like the same way that I might look at Star Wars. Mm-hmm. You look at it through that child's eyes and that's forever your perception of it. So that when you see the new thing, it just never match up to the expectations. Maybe I'm wrong about that, but that's my take on it.
No, I think you've got it right there. Like, Star Wars is a good analogy because you're more forgiving as a kid because you don't know all of the tricks to watching and even making a movie that you know when you're younger. So you're not fooled anymore. You know, it's with Sleepaway Camp, obviously, you know, the thing I talk about this a lot, you know, on these podcasts and also when I do the exegesis of movies over on Medium, but you're watching a movie that's also telling you a secondary story underneath. And one of the interesting things about Sleepaway Camp is that there's a monstrous sexual undercurrent throughout the whole thing. Everything that's said is sex from the point of view from somebody who doesn't have a good handle on sex. You've got like the pedophile who watches kids running down the hill and calling them baldies and stuff like that. And then you also have this horrific sexual reveal at the very end. And so you're watching a movie that's actually about something other than what you think you're watching. And it's really hard to pull that same trick twice. And so that's why I think the other Sleepaway Camps don't really have the same punch as the first one, because they're trying to make a movie about kids that get murdered at a camp, whereas the first movie was kind of this sort of – it's shocking in a way that you just – I don't think you can really make that same magic trick look original a second time, you know?
I'm going to say that the sequels probably went the more traditional route of what the genre had to offer.
I agree. Yeah, that's what I'm saying. They don't have that same weird sexual current that the first one has. And that's why a lot of the oomph is taken out of them a little bit.
What amazes me is that something that he spent $350,000 on, and he had just come out of NYU film school before this lawsuit that you were talking about, which is interesting. So if it hadn't been for that, he wouldn't have had the money to do this thing. And, you know, it's like Horatio Alger wound up making $11 million over the course. And I think it had a lot to do also with the fact that in the 70s, remember also you had the more violent stuff. You had the Friday the 13th and you had, this was more subdued. You did have the scene where that female counselor was knifed in the shower, very similar to, it was like kind of like a Psycho ripoff in a certain sense. Although she was just knifed from the back. But other than that, you know, what I think appealed to kids were the protagonists of this movie. The kids were the ones who were, who were basically, this was about them, not so much about the adults, except for Mike Kellen, I think his name was, who's a veteran character actor. This was his last film appearance, by the way. So I think that was kind of interesting. But I think that this was a more subdued response, and I just think that the fact that it was kind of subdued do throughout the film, except for, you know, the violence here and there. But then that last scene, they weren't expecting it, because it kind of zings at you that this is really a transsexual or a transvestite? I'm not sure, but I think he was originally a boy, and he actually survived. But the mother brought him up as a girl. So this last scene, which everybody talks about, really hits you in the pants.
And it's the reason why we're still talking about it.
Yeah, precisely.
That's exactly it.
What we're going to do is, before we go any further into the actual film itself, Will, do you want to give us a brief synopsis before we cut to our commercial break?
So, Sleepaway Camp is a 1983 slasher film starring Mike Kellen and Felissa Rose and Jonathan Tiersten. There's all sorts of really questionable sexual escapades happening as kids and campers and counselors alike are all getting murdered by an unseen, very giallo-style hidden murderer. There's a lot of sexual undercurrent. There's a lot of kids that look like kids in this movie, unlike, you know, the Friday the 13th franchise, where everybody appears to be 30. And then there is the mother of all twist endings at the very end of this movie. It's one of those gateway slasher movies, I think, that your older brother sort of slips you when your mom and dad aren't watching, and then you end up watching it by yourself and really regretting it. And then it stays with you for about 10 or 20 years, and you end up talking about it on a podcast.
Will, do you remember when you and I went to school together?
Yeah, we grew up together, Dave and I.
Oh, and okay. I remember, because I think we met in junior high school, but I remember in elementary school, right around fifth grade or so, it was on HBO. And the kids, maybe it wasn't even before that, might be like third grade.
Yeah.
The kids in our class were like, did you see that horror film about the boy?
Yeah.
Really, a girl is really a boy? And it was talk of all the kids. It was the stuff of legend when we were kids. And I think part of its popularity, it still rides that wave of a shock ending decades later.
This is the Literary License Podcast. We're going to cut to a commercial break, and then we'll be back with Sleepaway Camp, the 1983 cult classic.
Amazon. Oops, wrong Amazon. Although we both contain an array of diversity, the rainforest with all of its animals and us with all of our products, come check us over today and find all the products you need quickly and efficiently. And buy it with one click. And now you can even use us to donate to your favorite charities using Amazon Smile. Amazon Smile is worth your while. Come check us out today.
We are one planet. We share one extraordinary home. We are millions of wonders, but we are all one world. If we only get one chance to save our planet, to protect it for the next generation, then we have to take it. This is our chance. This is our fight. For our planet, for our home, for all of us. Join WWF today.
Dear Mom and Dad, I've been at a sleepaway camp for almost 3 weeks, and I'm getting very scared.
Welcome to Sleepaway Camp. Someone is watching you.
Hey, Mama, remove!
Someone is waiting for you. Someone wants to scare you to death.
Turn it! Turn the wheel!
Oh my God!
Sleepaway Camp. You won't be coming home.
Your favorite scary movie?
I have a bunch of favorite movies. I watch them all on Shudder.com for only $4.99 a month.
That's a scary low price.
But if I had to pick a favorite, it'd probably be Scream.
Oh.
Yeah, it's the only streaming service that lets me watch hundreds of horror movies on demand.
I'll be right back.
Hello? Hello? Hello, are you gonna subscribe? Hello?
Go to Shudder.com to subscribe, if you dare.
Okay, Bradley, tell the class about your holidays.
Yeah, it was really good. My dad built us a new kitchen. It's got wooden bench tops and some stupid self-closing drawers. There was a dishwasher that was a real and even a breakfast bar. Mum thought Dad was a massive...
Get a kitchen installed without teaching your kids new words. Visit ikea.com.au. We can plan, deliver, and install the whole f***ing thing for you.
Hello, welcome back to Literary License Podcast, and we're discussing the 1983 cult classic Sleepaway Camp. So, Dave, what are your thoughts about Sleepaway Camp?
Sleepaway Camp is like a combination of a generic 80s slasher film meets an after-school special as directed by John Waters. It is a one-of-a-kind, unique movie that I don't think has ever been paralleled for its own distinct fingerprint. It's, and part of me, I'll be honest, part of me loves it, part of me hates it. I had every emotion in the spectrum of emotions when I watched this film. And like Hereditary, it stays with you against your will. Once you introduce that Sleepaway Camp pill into your system, it never leaves your body. So I really appreciate the uniqueness that is this movie. And as performances, they're, like the rest of the movie, unique. Desiree Gould, I wound up working with years later on my debut film, Under Surveillance. And she plays Aunt Martha in a way that no other director would have allowed. And so many of these performances are wholly their own. They're not necessarily going for naturalism, certainly not Aunt Martha.
No.
It's
like the Ming Stole school of acting she comes across in this one.
and it's thoroughly memorable and thoroughly effective and terrific. But you have to go into this movie very open-minded, because it's not playing, it threw out the rule book. It threw out the rule book of conventional cinema. And if you embrace this off-kilter, absurdist slasher for what it is, you're going to love it.
I have to say that when I first saw it, I kind of enjoyed it, but it was one of those things. I was in uni, as I said before, went to the drive-in with a bunch of friends, and we watched this with a double feature with Boogeyman 2. Yeah, it was great. Great night at the cinema that night was. And I have to say that we watched it. It was like, we discussed it. It was something that we always discussed. And as she says before, it does burn its way into your memory and your subconscious. But reviewing it again through a 2019 lens, there's a lot in it to be, I mean, I'm not sure how a modern audience will take to it if they're discovering it for the first time, because there are some very questionable things in it that are considered now to be quite tasteless and horrible, as far as, you know, you got the, you know, well, you got the whole transgender issue, which is something totally different today. And then you got like the two gay dads, I guess it is, which you have to sit there and say that it's quite interesting that you got something from 1983 that does have this. But then, as Will was saying, you do have the pedophile saying that I call them baldies. And though I laugh every time I hear that, you think, oh, this is quite out there.
I think that's another word for it, tasteless.
Yeah.
It's rough, yeah. Wow.
But seeing it, I remember seeing it, and it's like these things just fly by. But then again, I guess it's a lot of, there's a lot of horror films that are now coming up viewing for, you know, that people are looking at old horror films and they are questioning things. Like, for instance, I was listening to this other podcast that I'm a big fan of, and they were mentioning, you know, Freddy versus Jason, and apparently there's a lot of people really upset with the Kelly Rollins, what she says before she's murdered. And they said that it ruins the film for them. They can no longer watch it because she calls Freddy, she calls Jason a fag, or she calls Freddy a fag. And so now it's like these people are now boycotting this film because of this happened. And this is, you know, this film came out in the early 2000s.
I hope they never watched the Monster Squad.
My God. I know, right? Like, people are so easily freaking offended these days.
Yeah, and I just found it quite interesting. And I also I've also watched another a YouTube video, basically, and they were discussing transgender killers in horror films, and they do mention this one. And then they had this transgender person on there saying that she was really offended by this movie because transgenders are not like this. But, you know, it's kind of like people are kind of missing the point. So it would be quite interesting to see what, if Sleepaway Camp does get a reboot, what they're going to actually do with it without offending anyone nowadays.
Well, you know, they've been talking about that reboot for so long. I wonder if they'll be able to do it. It might be, you know, I use this term. I'm not one of these kind of people that just slamming the PC movement. It is what it is.
Yes,
but I can imagine this film being neutered quite a bit if they try to...
Like, literally, yeah. They would neuter this movie. They would cut the balls right off the end frame. It would, I'm telling you, that they would, yeah.
What would the twist be? What would the twist? I mean, I guess you can go the traditional Psycho, and I never thought of this as being influenced by Psycho. But when you think about the shower scene, you think about the reveal at the end. I guess Hiltzik had Psycho as some kind of influence, but you'd have to wonder if they would change the twist at the end, or if they would just do it in a very different kind of way.
Well, I mean, look at the relationship between Mel and Meg. I mean, that is questionable. I mean, I can understand having daddy issues, but granddaddy issues, I don't know. I mean, it's kind of bizarre.
Things like that have happened, but why put it on film? You can make the choice as a filmmaker what you're going to put on the screen, and that's certainly a conscious choice, not a very good one, but a choice.
Well, it's just kind of a weird thing because the thing is, if Meg needed to go out with a counselor, there was plenty of counselors that are just a little bit older than her that they could actually have done it.
You mean like the muscle guy who's got the worst New York accent you've ever heard? What was the character's name? Yeah. You're like, hey, I want to know if you want to go out for some coffee.
I just called him Mullet Man. With my camera. You know, all business in the front and a party in the back, Mr. Mullet Man. And I have to sit there. Do you think that they had a costume designer on the show, or do you think everyone wore their own clothes? That's what I'm
wondering. I think everybody arrived to set with shorts, and the costume designer promptly cut them off at the pockets.
Your shorts aren't short enough. Come here, sir. Hanging out on that 12-year-old boy. Yeah, no. God.
I could just sit there and say that after watching this movie, I know the religion of every single guy in this film.
There's a scene towards the end where the bodybuilder, I can't remember his name either. I was calling him steroided Steve Perry.
Like Angelo?
What's that?
Is he Angelo? Either the actor's name?
Angelo? I don't know. But there's a scene where they're gathering the posse towards the very end to try and track down the killer in the woods. And his junk is like in the middle of the screen because he's standing on like a box talking. You guys know what I'm talking about? So yeah. Everybody else is at eye level with his penis, which is in the tightest pair of muscle shorts I've ever seen. Like, you can see his dick more clearly than you can see the mystery dick at the end of the movie, I think.
it's Paul D'Angelo playing Ronnie.
Yeah.
Okay. Ronnie. Oh, God. Of course his name's Ronnie. He looks like a Ronnie. He also looks like if Steve Perry, the original lead singer of Journey, just started working out, like, you know, on a mission, and he'd look like that eventually.
Kind of like Steve Perry's...
On CrossFit.
Well, like Steve Curry and Frank Stallone had a love child, and this is what
they Hi, Tom.
So I want to get a word in. When I first saw this, and of course I'm more of a Universal 30s and 40s fan, the classic cycle. So when I first saw this thing, I thought it was grade Z schlock. So I had to see it again. And I'm saying to myself, you know, this to me is a film that it just came at the right place at the right time. You know, I don't know what kind of forces were around in the universe. And indeed, I think the first 5 weeks, they only did like $90,000 in L.A., according to the Wikipedia research. But this thing picked up steam over a gradual period of time, perhaps also with the CD releases. And so this film probably got a lot more mileage, in my opinion, when it went into that venue than when it was originally shown in the theaters. Just like Star Trek, when it was originally on, you know, they had a small group of rabid fandom, but then it wasn't until it went into syndication that it really picked off. So it took off, I should say. So I think that this is a similar kind of concurrence, and it's. But you know, facts are facts. People latched onto it because of everything we've discussed, and you can't argue with success in that it spawned so many sequels. And I, for one, I would look forward to looking at the return to Sleepaway Camp, because I would like to see how Hiltzik handled. He wanted to just pick up where it left off from the first film. And, of course, Keith, you can speak more forcibly to that than I can, because you've seen it. I'm kind of wondering, did the sequel justify meet the original stuff? Or I don't know if we talked about that.
It had a low budget. It has its moments. I would say the best thing in it is Felissa Rose's makeup, because she plays two characters in it without, anyone listening to this, there are spoilers in this. So, I mean, if you're going to watch it, you might want to turn it off.
You can fix it in the edit.
Yeah, you can turn it off now and come and watch the sequel and come back. But, she plays a cop in it who's escaped from a mental institution. And she's the male cop all the way through it. And then she slowly peels off all their makeup and reveals herself to be Angela Baker.
Really?
Escaping. Angela Baker. I mean, the thing is, I can say about Felissa Rose is that she's aged incredibly well. I mean, you can sometimes you can look at a kid and you can see, you know, when they grow up, it's hard to tell who they are. But Felissa Rose looks exactly like Felissa Rose did back then. Just, you know,
not when she was the cop.
Not when she was a cop.
Did not make a handsome man, I'll tell you that much.
But they did an interesting thing with her voice, though, because they put a vocoder on it. You know, like
it was supposed to be somebody who lost their voice due to smoking, and that's how they masked it, which is a very clever idea. Mm. You know, to like, because I knew a little about the movie going into it, and I didn't pick up that it was her, and I knew she had a dual role. Mm-hmm. So they did a great job in that respect, certainly.
Yeah, I mean, I think she did a fantastic job in it. I said before, I was like you. I was like, I knew that she was in it, so I was watching it, waiting for her to show up. And when she wasn't showing up, but she was being mentioned again, I thought, oh no, here we go. It's going to be one of those things where, you know, they're just being mentioned, and then they're going to pop up 5 minutes in the end. But yeah, they did a really. It's a sequel to a B movie. I mean, they do a reasonable job. You know, it doesn't have the big reveal. I think the problem with this with the return is that they had this really fat, annoying kid that's being bullied all the time. But the thing is you wanted to bully him yourself, and that's the problem with that movie. Because, yeah, he's just one of those characters that you just hate, and there's nothing about him that hates. And he has this one pun line that smells like ass, and he says it over and over and over again. So, and you know, you're spending the whole time in there. You just want him dead. He was just annoying. It's a bit like the guy in the wheelchair in Texas Chainsaw Massacre, Franklin. It's like, you just want him dead. As soon as he starts opening his mouth, you want him dead. And unfortunately, the same character has that same Franklin vibe to him. So.
Okay.
So.
But with Felissa Rose had a terrific sense of humor, because to this day she's still asked to do the stare and the last reveal. And in my Cesar and Otto Summer Camp Massacre spoof of this film, I have we reenacted. It takes place at a summer camp. She's a counselor. This, you know, she's playing a counselor that's very much like Angela, quote unquote. And I had her do that stare numerous times. And she never complained about it. So to this day, 30-something years late, was it 30, more than 30 years later, she's still being asked to do what she did as a 13-year-old.
I have to sit there and say that when you look up information about Felissa Rose, everyone loves her. I mean, she's really embraced this character. And she hasn't, I mean, she's an icon because of this film. And I love that she embraces that being an icon because of this film. And she embraces that because there's not one bad thing said about her when it comes to fans, convention, stuff like this. And, you know, she really embraces it. My hat's off to her. Now, I do have some questions, though. As far as, what do you think, okay, let's sit there and say that you're a stage mom and you got your kid and you want them to be an actor. And not you know, we're not talking the main characters here, but then, you know, we're talking about the minor characters. And so you decide to throw all your children into this movie. Can you imagine what the parents thought when they went and saw this?
Oh, yeah.
And they saw their 12 and 13-year-olds running around in this movie.
Yeah, there were so many times. I watched this last night. I haven't watched it. It's one of those ones I've pulled out and watch every fucking couple of years, and you see something new in it. And I watched this one, and all I could think about was, like, during all of, like, the skinny dipping scenes and everything like that, there's people running around, and some of them are, like, 12, and some of them are obviously in their 30s. It's just, come on, man.
It's like ancient Greece.
Yeah, really. It was New York in the late 70s, early 80s, man. That's just some wild, wild west shit going on out there. But I think that part of the reason this movie is so unsettling is that it doesn't look like it was shot under the safest conditions at all times either. You know, they just kind of, it's one of those ones that, you know, you can watch some movies and you can sort of get a sense that they're being made on the fly in a lot of ways. And it either works for or against the movie. In this case, it works for. But again, I think part of it's very unsettling to watch at the same time, you know.
Well, I thought the cinematography was pretty good. I was looking. In fact, I was more impressed with the scenes of the lake and the water than I was with a number of those scenes between the characters. Yeah. And and I think that may have been a kind of a countertop kind of a counter thing, like, you know, you've got the scenery, the bucolic atmosphere versus all the horror that's going on with that kind of wonderful background, you know. And that reminded me in a way of the Poltergeist. I think it was Poltergeist. Remember the way it starts out, the way Spielberg starts out, that it's such a wonderful town, and you've got upbeat music and marvelous, you know, and everybody's going about their daily lives, and it kind of lulls you into a sense of false comfort. And then all of a sudden, these things start to come on. So I think there's an interesting juxtaposition. I think it was I think it was accidental. And by the way, from my research, it looks like they had storyboards, and something happened. They threw out all the storyboards before they started the movie.
That's awesome.
And it shows. It really shows. So they were really, it's kind of Chaplin-esque in a way, you know, where, you know, I'm directing the scene and what the hell happens, and, you know, which is the way he did it. So it was this serendipity, this accidental juxtaposition of events that led to, it was very deep. You can really analyze this thing on a number of levels. But I think that was certainly part of the, I'm working with a movie without storyboards is pretty rare these days, which reminds me of Chaplin. So I think that's part of the issue.
I have to sit there and say that I found it quite... There are some parts of this film that's like just... I just kind of wonder if... Does anyone know if the director and the screenwriter, I don't know, did he partake in, you know, I don't know, college and recreational drugs maybe? Because it just seems to kind of... I like this film a lot. I promise you, I'm not slashing this film because I own this on Blu-ray. I actually used to have the box set with all the films together at one point on DVD. So yeah, I'm pathetic in that way. But I do enjoy watching this film. But I do sometimes look at it from a screenwriter's point of view, and it's just like, what gave him the idea to, you know, like, okay, we're gonna have two gay dads and they're gonna kids and this accident's gonna happen and it's gonna turn out to be this. Now I do understand that I mean sometimes I kind of wonder if he was a William Castle fan because this does have little slivers of homicidal going on in it at the same time.
Oh yeah, I could see that. Actually, I hadn't thought of that, but now that you mention it.
Because he does have that, you know.
Well, you know, you look at, we're all subject to our influences. I was saying clearly there's some psycho influence here. There's probably William Castle. And then you kind of put all your influences into a blender and come out with this menagerie that is Sleepaway Camp.
Yeah, I've often thought that, like, that sort of slasher film explosion that happened from 75 to 85 was kind of a lot like, this sounds crazy, but it reminds me a lot of the blues in that you have a basic chord progression to a blues song that you can build on and then sort of take away from here and there. And if you watch these movies like, you know, Halloween, fucking Sleepaway Camp, Friday the 13th, Night of the Prowler, all of the giallo flicks from the Italy and stuff like that, they have this sort of similar skeletal structure to them in the same way that blues songs do. And I don't know, the two just kind of remind each other. Also, I just wanted to put this out. I don't know if it's true or not, but I got this vibe last night as I was watching this. Did anybody else get the feel like a lot of the dialogue that takes place in the camp also sort of looks like if you ever went to a summer camp where somebody's holding like a dramatic, like if you watch a summer camp play, it sort of looks like the way that they're all behaving to each other at this camp, which was
like really drama cool. Camp, like drama camp.
Yes. Like, like they were all doing drama camp vignettes at their drama. Yeah, seriously. Like, I don't know if that's too meta or not.
I want to make a slasher film now called Drama Camp.
You should be great.
You should do that. If anybody could pull it off, yeah, I could. I'd watch your drama camp.
About a slasher at a drama camp. His part was cut. Now it's payback time.
Yeah. and they're all doing some kind of really bad musical. Yep. I mean,
I think it should be mentioned, by the way, that the final film in the trilogy, it's titled Sleepaway Camp Reunion. So Hiltzik has been working on that since 2014. He has a distributor, and it's in the works. And he was tweaking the script. He's been tweaking the script for 4 years. So, so we'll see what happens on that. So he wants to, again, retain the key characters from the original, and he wants to modernize it a little bit. And the other guy, Michael Simpson, who did the sequels, 2 and 3, which were Sleepaway Camp 2 and Happy Campers and Sleepaway Camp 3 Teenage Wasteland. So he is going to be doing a movie also called Sleepaway Camp Berserk. So you've got two now separate directors with their own take on the franchise, so to speak, and it looks like they may be competing with each other.
Well, also, neither might get made. Both might get made. A lot of films that are in pre-production go into production hell, and nothing becomes of them. So, yeah. Really hard to tell. Even when it came to Return to Sleepaway Camp, that thing was in limbo for years before it finally got re-released. Before it finally got released. So, you never know if either or both of those films that are currently tied up will happen. And I know there's probably some right issues as well.
Yeah. Because, I mean, I wonder who owns the rights to it now. That would be quite interesting.
I think he still does. I think Hiltzik still does. Mm-hmm. Actually, he does. According to this, he owns the rights to the Sleepaway Camp franchise, which is of 2013 was to be rebooted. So this information is a little old, but he apparently still owns. So he was smart enough to retain that.
I mean, what's also interesting about the release of Sleepaway Camp, it came out in 1983, but it was the 1 year that Friday the 13th didn't come out with a sequel in the 80s. It's the only year that they missed out because they were doing Friday the 13th, part 3 in 3D.
And maybe that's part of the reason why, part of its success, part of the reason it made $11 million, because it filled the void.
And by the way, just for the trivia-minded, it was also released under the title of Nightmare Vacation. So some people may know it in, under that title rather than, but it seems to me that Sleepaway Camp is pretty popular.
After 35 years of endless discussions that began in the elementary school rooms all the way to the college rooms and people probably in their 50s and 60s still bringing it up, you remember that movie? You remember that movie? I think all grounds have been covered.
Yeah, I have to agree. There's actually a really good podcast out there that discusses that. That's so funny. It's, let's see if I can find the name of it. But basically, they discuss Sleepaway Camp, and because they couldn't work out the relationships between who was what's father and how the aunt fixed in and everything like this, and whether the two gay one of the gay guys is married to the aunt, it is quite funny.
Yeah.
And it's called How Did They Get This Made is the name of the podcast. I suggest looking this up on YouTube. And it's so funny that someone's actually animated it as well. So you can see the animation.
Do you know, I would like to offer this. I ran into Kevin Smith at an airport, filmmaker, actor Kevin Smith.
Mm-hmm.
We had a discussion about Sleepaway Camp because I had heard him bring it up on Smodcast. And if you put in Kevin Smith and my last name, Campfield, I took the piece of his podcast where he bought up our conversation on Smodcast. I was telling him that I had just made a spoof with Felissa Rose, and she makes that same face, and he was so blown away by the fact that I brought the same actress back. I found her all these years later, and I made this film. So look at Kevin. Even Kevin Smith is a big fan. There's someone that I know, one of the biggest agents in Hollywood I'm friendly with. He remembers Sleepaway Camp. So this is like an undercurrent. Like even some of the most successful people in Hollywood like this film, or certainly were influenced by this film in their formative years. It has a reach beyond first glance. And, that's the mark of a truly memorable film. By the way, if you want to see Desiree Gould, Desiree Gould played Aunt Martha. I have a video up on YouTube, Caesar and Otto Meet Dracula's Lawyer. It's part of the series, and she plays the wife of Steve Dracula. So if you want to see her return, it's on there as well.
All right. So, Tom, what are your final thoughts on Sleepaway Camp?
So this, to me, is a... once again, a film that came along at the right place at the right time. The director, fresh out of law school with no money, won a lawsuit, decided to gamble it, and won out. Almost as once I said, it's kind of a Chaplin-esque rendering, considering the storyboards were thrown out, they were literally working from scratch. Undoubtedly, it has made money for the business, which is the bottom line. And people are still talking about the ending, which is kind of going. And that's the thing that really distinguishes, I think, this movie from the other movies of the genre, in that it brings the psychosexual and transsexual elements, plus the other elements that were basically touched. It were back in the 80s, were really more taboo. Keith, you brought up an excellent point. If the movie had come out today, would it have gotten the same kind of recognition that built up, or would it be looked at as, oh, ho hum, another one of those? So,
probably picketed.
Yeah.
Endless posts on some social media, people complaining about they're so offended. So, Will, what are your final thoughts on Sleepaway Camp?
Just that it's a phenomenal time capsule. It's one of the weirdest movies I think that's out there. And it's weird in ways that, like, you know, we just, we're only sort of halfway grasping every time you watch it. It manages to somehow be both more and less sex positive than the world we live in now. I don't know exactly how the fuck that happens, but it somehow does. Also, guys, fashion comes and goes. I want to just throw this out there, and you know, we've had a lot of fun here, but this is a very serious subject. Younger men listening to this, boys who happen to be listening to this growing up right now, it's not okay to wear a half shirt ever. And just not wear half shirts. I know this was the horrible thing that happened in the time that it was there. We need to recognize that, let it go, walk away from it. If you're thinking right now about putting on a half shirt right now, I don't care what your abs look like. It's don't. Just don't. Say no.
Oh, man. I got to get rid of all my half shirts now.
I know. So, I love this movie to pieces, and I'm really glad we got to talk about it. So, that's it.
What about your final thoughts, Dave? What are your final thoughts?
I think I pretty much said them all. I mean, it was a film that, I'll put it this way. When I first met Felissa Rose, I had not seen the movie yet. And I thought, what a great actress she is. What a great person. I was on the set of a local commercial and found out that she was the star of Sleepaway Camp, rented it. This is the early 2000s. And said, what the F was that? And what started off is, because I didn't see it in my formative years. And I wasn't a kid when I saw it. But any film that stays with you the way that does has something special about it. And it inspired me enough to make that spoof of it. And it will always stand the test of time for being a one-of-the-kind slasher film that will never truly be repeated even by the director itself.
Mm-hmm. I mean, personally, for me, I love Sleepaway Camp. It's one of those films I always remember. And I love when someone comes over and they haven't seen it, because it's one of those films that you love to show people just to watch it. And they do, you know, and you do get that thing where they're rolling their eyes through most of it. And then the end comes and they're like, what the hell did I just see? And it's one of those. I mean, there are other films that I do try to do that, you know, it's one of my, that's bring people over to watch horror films and try to shock them, like Cannibal Holocaust or I Spit on Your Grave or something like this. But Sleepaway Camp is a bit more fun than those films. And I think the film's going to live on and on and on. As you know, I've shown it to my nieces and my nephew. I've shown it to my godchildren. I have 12 of them, and they've all, you know, they're all teenagers or in their 20s now. And I've shown it to all of them, and they, you know, they all like it. So it seems like it's going to be living on and on for generations to come. And for a simple fact that even my niece has now shown it to her boyfriend, who she's engaged to get married to, he's never seen it before, and he's like, oh my God, he went and bought a copy after seeing it. You know, these are like 18 to 21 year olds. So it is finding an audience, which, you know, I think Sleepaway Camp is one of those films that's going to live long past all of us here. So,
yeah.
So this brings us to the end of our discussion of Sleepaway Camp, the 1983 cult classic. We'd like to thank our guests. Thank you, Tom. And thank you, Will. Will, where can they find you on the internet if they need to look for you?
Anybody can find me over at medium.com. I'm cranking out a couple of articles every week. I do my my series on the tarot over there, and also the exegesis of Salem's Lot, where I actually break down a lot of the, kind of like what we're doing here, I just kind of break down a lot of what was happening in the culture at the time that book was being written, and examine a little bit, I go a little bit deeper into some of the real world analogs to the some of the fancy supernatural stuff you see in there, tying in things like, organized crime, mind control, MKUltra, stuff like that. So it's fun. Anyway, so look for me there at medium.com, and thanks for listening.
And what about yourself, Dave? Where can people find you? Where they can follow what you're up to?
You can find me on Twitter, twitter.com/DaveCampfield. You can find me on Facebook. My website is fourthhorizoncinema.com. If you go to YouTube and type in Summer Camp Massacre, Cesar and Otto's Summer Camp Massacre should come up. And it's got 500,000 views. You can see Felissa Rose spoofing the very movie that we've been talking about today. And see Trey Byers in his first role, who went on to currently co-stars in Empire. So I hope to catch everybody on the internet.
And of course, you can follow us on www.llpodcast.com. We're also located on Facebook, Twitter, Reddit, Tumblr, and all the other social medias. And we're also now on YouTube. So if you want to listen to our podcast on YouTube, it's a great channel to watch us on. Though if you're looking for visual to go along with audio, unfortunately, we're only audio. So you'll have to use your imagination there.
For now.
For now. Our next episode will be, we're going into July 2019, will be Out of the Mind of Curtis, where we celebrate some of the works of Dan Curtis. Our first episode of July will be Burnt Offerings for our book, The Screen, based on the book by Frank Mancuso and directed by Dan Curtis, starring Betty Davis, Karen Black, and Oliver Reed. So we'd like to say goodnight to you all now. So say goodnight, Tom.
Goodnight, all.
Say goodnight, Will.
Goodnight, Will.
Say goodnight, Dave.
Goodnight, everyone.
And goodnight for myself, and we'll hear from you next week with Burnt Offerings.
She's a boy. Andy Warhol working in a factory, S&M superstar, sleeping on the Bowery, and looking so pretty. Late night vampire, hustling a nightmare, back alley blow job and down on your knees. Strong out on novice romance.
Transvestite, transsexual, head chicks with tits all getting their kicks.
Bet you never thought you'd wind up like this now. The cold sweats again. Oh, ain't it boring? Sanctified sisters and Hong Kong junkies, and gratification is all I got and all I want.
Simply would not do. Oh no, absolutely not. A little girl would be so much nicer, don't you think so, Angela?
Angela, such a lovely name.
Transvestite, transsexual, and chicks with dicks all getting their kicks.
wind up sleeping with one of the trash brats. Wind up going down on it, perfect baby.
That
you never thought you'd wind up being mortal.
I dreamed of a little girl just like you.
I mean, we already have a boy, so another one simply would not do. Oh no, absolutely not. A little girl would be so much nicer, don't you think so, Angela?
Angela, such a lovely name.
Why, I believe it means angel. Why, yes, I'm sure it does. I know you're going to like that name. Won't you, Peter?